Welcome back to Charge to the Game podcast. It's your host, Terius Lawton. I'm back with my second podcast, my second interview. I have a special guest right here, Ole Miss legend. Ole Miss legend, man. One of the best receivers that ever came through Ole Miss.
All right, I'm Shay Hodge, man, from Morton, Mississippi. Played college football at University of Mississippi, Ole Miss. Went on to the NFL. And currently now I'm a pass game coordinator at Jackson Academy, and I run one of the biggest 707 organizations in Mississippi called Mesh Academy.
Y'all might have heard of them, seen them on YouTube, on Instagram. Y'all might have seen them on TikTok, you know, getting saucy. He got all the four stars, five stars, man. Plenty of college recruits on his team, man. I think the whole team is college recruits, man. How did you manage to do that?
You know, it started from training, you know. Actually, let me go back. It was D.D. Bowie, you know. When I was volunteered at Morton, seeing him as I was coaching him, man, and he... You know, and I seen what he could do, and I got his name out there to the media and everything, and then end up meeting the 707 coach called, his name is Demetri Warren. And he kind of showed me the ropes, and then I ended up starting training, you know, having a training business. And most of the time, I always had my hands on the top kids in the state already, and then I just turned it into having my own team with Mike Espy. You know, we always touch all the top kids in the state, and we say, hey, why not start our own team, man?
That's a blessing, man, to be up under a legend, man. You want to tell us about your childhood, like growing up?
Yeah, man. Morton, Mississippi, man. I grew up, I always tell people it's the hood, you know. Being in the country, people think that it's not a hood in the country, but there's a hood everywhere. It's where poverty, you know, with a lot of crime and stuff. So I was right in the midst of all that. All my friends were about 5 to 10 years older than me. A lot of guys that was older that was still in the hood and selling drugs on the corner, playing basketball, which helped me with my competitive nature. Playing against guys that were older than me that made me who I am today. Had a tough little childhood with my mom. You know, we always bumped heads, but, and people think, you know, I was kind of misunderstood as a child. You know, I was always nice and stuff, but I always reacted to a lot of things. And if people did stuff to me, man, it painted a picture of me.
Like right there, you
is. Yeah, it painted a picture of me, man, that it wasn't true. And, you know, overall, it was just pretty tough, but sports helped me. You know, coaches helped me. They got me on the right path and taught me how to deal with things, you know, deal with adversity, deal with, you know, when things don't go my way, deal with people that don't like me, you know, becoming like a star, probably like a 5 or 6 years old. I'm 5 or 6 years old playing with the second, third grade at halftime in the basketball games of the high school game. So, you know, without sports, my childhood, I don't know what it would be, you know, probably to this day, you wouldn't even see Shay Hodge right now if it wasn't for my childhood, the way I grew up.
So you give that all that right there to the coach that allowed you to play? At a young, very young age?
I would say the coaches and my environment, you know, even the guys that would be considered bad, you know, those guys instilled a lot in me. They made me tough. They made me really, really tough. I was the runt. I was really small.
You were small up. Then?
Yeah, I was small. I was really small. And, you know, they beat me up every day, made me super tough, man, and it built me, man. It made me into a warrior. It made me into a fighter, man. And it's the coaches that built me up, my mom and dad, James Hodge, Victoria Hodge, and also the coaches I give the most credit to, because they seen a different side of me. They seen a side of me that came out for everybody to see now. And the Shay Hodge that they see now, is I credited that to the coaches.
Gotcha, man. That's crazy, man, that you played at a very, very young age, man. Not too many people can do that. Not too many people can do that, man. I know I can't. But I still think, man, let me just throw this in the interview real quick. I still think I'm the best receiver in the family, though. I just want to throw it out there. I think I'm the best receiver. What you think?
Hey, look, I'm with you. Go ahead. You can have it.
Okay, man. You want to tell us about, let's dive right into your teenage years. What was it like in your teens, like growing up, you know, up until your high school?
My teenage years is exactly when it started with my mom. Probably like 12 going to 13, so say 13, where we started to really bump heads. And she started to try to hold me out of a lot of sporting events when we couldn't agree on things, you know, inside the house. I just felt like we were so much alike. I feel like a lot of things I went through were mental, you know. Like, I had a good life growing up, but it's like mentally we just never connected for whatever reason. And going into high school in ninth grade, that's when the coaches came along. Well, I had coaches early on, you know, Andre Hollis, Zoo. One of the biggest ones I love to death is Danny Greaves, who won the state championship in Morton, man. He had me so young, and I was with him all the time being a manager. When they won the state championship, I was there, and he just took me on his wing and taught me a lot of things that I know today. And that went on into high school, but then he ended up leaving my eighth grade year going to ninth grade, and it broke my heart, man. I wanted to play for him in high school and win state championship. I was always a basketball player before I was a football player. football just came in high school, you know, ninth grade. I mean, I played all the way through 6 through 12, but football was something I really didn't like because of the physicality. I never wanted to get tackled. And I was real small, so.
You didn't want to be rough, huh?
Yeah, I didn't want to be that rough, but I had a best friend named Jermaine Washington. We called him Punch, man, and I have to give him a lot of credit, too. Like, he was a tough guy. He introduced me to a lot of hood things that actually molded me.
Hood thing,
you know, like knowing a lot of things I probably shouldn't have knew at that age, growing up a little bit too fast. But I never got into it. I had to get the hood credit, man. They never tried to pull me with them. They always pushed me to go play sports and don't be around what we doing,
so
man.
So they wasn't the ones that said, hey, come with us, or if you didn't come with us, you lame. And they didn't put pressure to do anything.
Nah, they didn't put
pressure. So pretty much they're like, hey, man, you know, we doing what we doing.
I credit them for a lot, man. They did the right things as being the older guys.
Can you tell us about your football career, man?
Football career, I would say it started around about sixth grade. You know, I was still 12 and got to play Pee Wee football. That's when my first big success happened. We won state championship in Pee Wee.
Okay.
I started out as a running back, but I actually was in seventh grade, but I was still 12. So, right. So I was a quarterback in seventh grade football, but I was a running back with the Pee Wee team because I was still 12.
That's crazy.
Ran for a bunch of yards, won MVP, won state championship. And then, you know, seventh, eighth grade, though, I wasn't that good. I was just an average player, you know. But then when ninth grade hit, from eighth to ninth grade, I grew a whole foot from about 5'2 to 6'2. In one summer.
So, man. You went from here to...
Yeah, I became from the little runt to the tallest dude around. So, and it helped my athletic ability. I always could run and jump and stuff, but once I got a little taller, man, I became more dominant. In ninth grade, man, I had 50 touchdowns. I had a 25 throwing and 25 rushing, went undefeated. I ended up starting in ninth grade in high school. I took the senior spot in high school. And honestly, I was going to quit football in ninth grade because I was always a basketball player. I wanted to go to... My dream was to go to Arizona and play basketball.
Man.
That was my dream. So in ninth grade, I said, man, I'm going to quit. I'm going to start focusing on basketball to make sure I get my scholarship and everything I wanted. But then the light hit me in ninth grade, and I said, man, look, if I'm this good and this dominant, I got to continue to play both. And that's what I did, man. And once I got on up to 11th grade, I figured out, man, it's 2 rounds in the NBA draft. It's 7 rounds in football.
You got a better chance.
Better my eyes. I'm 6'2 in basketball. 6'2, 6'3 in basketball. I'm considered small. In football, 6'2, 6'3 receiver, I'm considered big. So I made the choice. Actually, I'm supposed to play both in college, but I made the choice. I actually made the choice to play both, but then when I got there, I said, man, I can't take it on. It's too much. Then, you know, in college early on, you know, as a freshman, I played a lot. I started a lot of games, but I didn't do what I expected to do. So then that's another reason why I quit football. Right. I mean, quit basketball. I went out there for about 2 weeks. And I said, nah, man, I got to get good in the sport that I know that I'm trying to go professional in.
Right,
so
right.
I let it go. And my sophomore year, I ended up starting, but I ended up breaking my foot after I won a starting job. Like, it's a bunch of adversity,
man,
in this story.
Bro.
Then my coach get fired. I mean, that year goes by. I got to play. I mean, I actually ended up starting that year, too. It happened in the summer. So I got to play in that season. I did really good. I was second in yards and catches. I actually led the team in catches. I was second in yard with Mike Wallace, who played for the Steelers.
Everybody knows.
So, yeah, I had great teammates, man. And then my coach get fired that year. New coach come in, Coach Nutt, man. My 11th grade, my junior year. My junior year, and I started to take off, man. 725 yards, 8 touchdowns. I'm one of the top players in the nation, SEC. And then going to my senior, I ended up breaking all the school records, you know, the single season record. Career record, the first 1,000-yard receiver ever, led the SEC, honorable mention All-American. So it was like a storybook ending, other than one part, you know. Junior year going, my senior year, I ended up having severe acne, and something I never hardly talk about. It's supposed to be in my book, but it hindered me into the point of I took this medicine to fix my acne, so I could put on my helmet and stuff. I had like 50 bumps. Man.
So I'm getting exclusive here.
Yeah, you
getting
exclusive.
Yeah,
okay, this is exclusive info.
I'm getting exclusive.
Some people know it. Some people know. Most people don't. What happened? But it ended up deteriorating the cartilage in my knee. So I played that whole senior year basically on one leg. I was hurt.
Oh, man.
So that messed up my NFL. I had a second round, third round grade coming out to go to the NFL. I went to the combine. They figured it out. You know, they went through medicals and they knew. I never knew.
Man.
And so that's the story of how I went undrafted, because everybody asked, how do you be the first 1,000 receiver? How do you break the single season record? How do you break the career record? How do you be unmentioned All-American? The SEC is the best conference in America. How did that happen? And there go the story nobody really knows. So,
man,
that's what happened to my football career. And, you know, I try to battle back and make it back. I made it. Got to play with Terrell Owens and Chad Johnson with the Bengals, which was huge.
Tell me, you did what?
Yeah, I got to play with those guys. You know, a lot of my training I do now, watching Chad go, man, in person and seeing that, man, it catapulted my career and made me see why God allowed things to happen the way it happened. Because it wasn't meant for me to be the man anymore. It was meant for me to come back and do what I'm doing now, you know, training and everything, but we'll get to that.
Man, I'm gonna tell you something you didn't know. Before I ever met you, before I even realized we were family, we were related, anything, I used to play with you on NCAA.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I used to play with you on NCAA. I didn't have to boost no speed, no nothing,
they,
man.
They had me like, my senior, I think I'm like a 91, 92. I always play myself, too.
Hey, man, I didn't even know nothing about it, man. I was just throwing the ball up. High, I'm like, this dude, right, bro, that's a bad kid, man. I'm young. I'm young as age, man.
Right.
Until my dad told me, he was like, you know, that's your cousin. I was like a kid in the candy store. I was excited. I was like, that's my cousin playing. Right. I didn't have to create no player or nothing. I'm playing. I'm playing with my family member. But man, yeah, that's crazy, man. Can you tell us, you said your injury, what kind of led you away from, you know, going professional, which you did play, you know, you was in the roster, whatever you said. But so what led you into the coaching?
early on, everybody kind of knew I was going to be a coach. I love teaching people, man. Something about it, like teaching somebody something new or teaching somebody and getting them to get it. But even like my teammates in high school, I caught a lot of the plays. Even in college, you know, the younger kids that came in when I was a senior and junior, I was always the one trying to mentor them and coach them and teach them the plays and how to run the routes and everything. But to the real reason or how it sequentially happened was I kept chasing the NFL and I knew what I wanted to do for a living after football, but I just didn't want to start it and then go after football and then try to come back.
Right.
So I had got my knee fixed in New York. With the Regina kind of treatments that Kobe got done to his knee to get back to playing.
Uh-huh.
And it got me healthy enough to go to the CFL. I made a CFL roster. I went to a tryout.
I remember.
Made the team, went through training camp, but I ended up hurting myself again, figuring out that my ankle had the same type of deterioration going on too.
Oh,
so,
man.
At that point, I asked God way before it ever even happened. I said, God, if you give me another chance to show me what you want me to do, I'll do what you want me to do. I promise. So once I got hurt again, I was on the plane riding. I cried coming back home, man. I was in the airport, just boo-hooing, like, man, it's finally over. Like, I can't do it, but now I know why. So it catapulted me to my career, man. I went on and I'm gonna put my foot in the ground. I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna make these kids better. I'm gonna become a coach and do what I was meant to do. And that was like in 2016. Really, I did a little bit in 2014. I volunteered, but 2016 is when I put my foot in the ground and I actually started to do 7-on-7. Doing 7-on-7, and then it catapulted me into an offensive coordinator job at Provine High School.
Provine.
Then the next following year, it catapulted me into a head coaching job at Hillcrest Christian School. And then after that, I kind of got burnt out on it because of some things that happened and dealing with administration that I didn't understand at the time. I was young, but it helped me to where I'm at now. I took time out and I started just training for a living and doing it on my own, working at D1 Jackson. Did about 2 years, 3 years, and then the job at Jackson Academy opened up and they asked me to come interview for it. Did a great job, and man, now I'm here at Jackson Academy. Man, it's the best decision I ever made in my life.
What y'all see here, man, this yeah, camp right is lovely, man. Yeah. This whole field, I fell in love with the first one. When I first stepped on it, man, I loved it, man. I wish I can come coach, but you know, I don't have the ability to do so.
But yeah, so I coaching here now, man, I'm the pass game coordinator, the college recruiting coordinator. I got a great schedule in the classroom where I don't have to do a whole lot, and I'm just, you know, mostly here to support the kids mentally and physically with football and then with teaching them things in the classroom. And then I got a great coaching staff. Great coaching staff, man. I don't expect to leave this place for a long time. Hope it all stays the same.
So you don't plan on going nowhere?
Nah, at least for about 5 years, man. I want to stay here and learn and embrace this culture. And when it's time for me to branch out and go do my own thing, I'll be fully ready and equipped with everything that I need to make it successful.
Can you tell us about your how did you meet Demario Davis with the Devoted Dreamers? When they started at 7-on-7, how did that come about? How did you get added on to that roster as being a coach?
I actually started with Demetri Warren. He had a team called Mississippi Grind.
Okay.
And some things happened where, you know, the way he ran his program, it wasn't nothing bad about him. It just I didn't agree with everything. And so I ended up was going to change over. And Demario was starting up a team. And I had some insight to him. I forgot. Oh, actually his cousin wanted some coaches, and we was the two, me and Vernon Price, who one of my best friends in coaching and in real life, you know. He told me about it, and he was like, man, they're looking for some coaches, man. We might as well go over there because we did a great job with this. We want to do something new. So went over there, introduced ourselves, and we got to do the tryout and everything, and it catapulted from there, man. We hit it off, and we had a good 4 years, and
about four years,
something like that. And then eventually me and Mike said, and Price said, you know, we want to do our own thing. We want to be able to control everything about it and do it the way we want to do it. There's no disrespect to anybody. We just want to do it our own way. And now that's what you see now, Mesh Academy, man, and we loving it. So that's how I met DeMario, man, a great man, great guy, man. Great program. It's somebody that I cherish for the rest of my life and in the time we spent together.
Man, Mesh Academy, man. Let's talk a little bit more about Mesh Academy. Like, I know you said that y'all came together, y'all wanted to do this, but like, what was the behind, like, how did y'all find the players and how did y'all get the,
So it really comes from like recruiting in a sense. Having a name in recruiting, being a recruiting specialist, knowing all those coaches see me playing college and they know me. And then when I was right on a few kids, they like, man, he know what he's talking about. He's a talent evaluator. He's really good at that. So having that behind me was a big thing. Having training behind me was a big thing, because the one thing, the things that kids want is they want to get exposure.
Right.
They want to get recruited.
Right.
They want to get life-changing experiences, a place they would never go by themselves.
Right.
And the other last part, can you make them better?
And then I check all those boxes. Yeah, you got all of that.
And I check all those boxes, and then having the people behind me that believe in my mission, that funds everything for it, where my kids don't have to pay. And we just, you know, we just get to have fun.
Man, that's amazing, man. That's amazing, man.
Blessings, man, guys.
That's a big blessing. That's a big blessing.
So another thing that I do, I have influence over, not over the rankings, but influence. They talk to me and consult with me on how, who should be where. And so a lot of those guys that got 4 and 5 stars, I've had a big hand in it, you know, being able to push their names. They got to prove it to me first. And then once they prove it to me, and I go and do my little deal with the college coaches, with the media, you know, Rivals, 247, On Three, which is the biggest one or the newest one now, the same guy that made all three of those.
Right.
He's now that's the one he's made. So having a connection with those guys and being able to influence things, man, it just makes it better for our kids. And it's like, who else would you rather play for, is the way they look at it. And I love it the same way, man. I love kids. That's the only thing that saved me was a coach. Somebody like me saved me, so now I want to save everybody else. Because I'm in Jackson. A lot of killing, a lot of stealing, you know, a lot of things. The only thing that can really take these kids away from me is sports.
Right.
And so I try to use sports to bring those talented kids. Any kid, honestly, I'll train and make better. I don't care who it is. But with those talented kids, man, it's really, really hard, because like I talked about, when I was young, I was in the spotlight early. So people judge me a lot harder than everybody else. So now I know what those kids are facing and what they're going to go against. So when you're a 4-star, everybody's watching and micromanaging. It's like you LeBron James, or where you at.
Right.
So everything you do is going to get amplified. So me teaching them how to handle it, along with me as an adult now, man, I get to be real with those kids. Like, I've made mistakes even during like our last 7-on-7. I got, you know, somebody got inside my head and I did something uncharacteristic. I'm glad they got to see that, because now you can learn from me, like, watch how I go going forward after I make a mistake.
Right.
Same thing those kids going to have to do too. You know, adversity is adversity. You got to learn and grow. And so, just a blessing God put me in this position to help those kids, and I'm just like they were, and I can mold them and teach them everything that I know.
Most definitely, man. I know it's probably a blessing. These kids probably love to be with you, to be associated with you, to be able to talk to you, to be able, you know, learn from one of the best receivers that ever came through Mississippi. Question number one, even though I know you probably already answered this, what inspires you to start the Miss 7-on-7?
I would say Demetri Warren. Okay. I just want to make sure I say it right. Demetri Warren. I would have to say Demetri Warren. Watch him operate and how he did things and how he had all those talented kids in one spot, doing for those kids, taking them places. Like, you have to be selfless to do that stuff. And one of the main things I love in life is helping kids, man. I want to help them grow and help them. Like, I still have a lot of kiddie features about me. You know, some people that's older will be like, man, he's too kiddie. But when you know me, you know me.
I'm all
about my business when it comes to football and the stuff that you have to be, like, stern with or be serious about. So I say Demetri Warren, and then watching other people do their organizations, and it made me look at the flaws or whatever they did and try to make my thing better. Just like, you know, like McDonald's and
Right.
I feel like Chick-fil-A is the one who learned from all their mistakes, and now then they got the best.
Got the best. Yeah, right. You sure
that's
right.
That's what I'm looking at.
You sure right. Question number two, how do you think others view you?
Man, I think it's 50-50. I think it's 50-50. I think it's right down the middle. You got this side that loves me.
It's a love-hate relationship.
Yeah, it's like this side loves me, and man, look what he's doing for those kids. And then you got this side over here that's like, look who he think he is, and he think he's better than people. But overall, man, I just hope people understand who I really am.
Yeah, right.
Heart of gold, give anybody a shirt off my back. It just, man, I say the way I grew up is what made people not like me, because when you disrespect me, I'm still a human. Even though I'm looked at in a certain light because I've done a lot of things, I'm still a human. Like, respect me, because if you don't, it'll cause me to do something. Sometimes I'm uncharacteristic and I'll be impulsive at times,
and
act a certain way. And I think that's what paints a bad picture of me at times. But at the end of the day, if you really know me, even after that altercation or whatever happened, you will still feel the genuineness out of me of like, man, it's what I did to him normally what caused him to do that. But at the end of the day, like, I got to teach the kids, it don't matter what they do, you got to control you.
Right.
So that 50-50, a lot of it I think I caused on myself, but like, I'm about respect, man. I grew up in the hood, man. If you disrespect me, normally we going to fight.
Yeah,
as an adult, you don't fight.
You're right.
So I just changing my ways from that fighting kid that's trying to fight for respect to the adult that has, you know, have to see the bigger picture. Like, okay, no matter what they do, you got to act a certain way, especially being at Jackson Academy and being around these great people in this great organization, man. I mean, this great school. I gotta uphold the standard at all times.
Right. Question number 3. How does it feel to have the youth look up to you?
Man, it's amazing. It's amazing. I normally write a grateful journal every night. I used to write it in the morning. And it's one thing I always thank God for, man. Having influence, and people look up to me, because the only thing that got me here was me looking up to people.
Right.
You know, like Deuce McAllister, Ty Pinkston. There are some guys that didn't make it as far, but like, those are two notable names that.
Right.
And Allen Iverson was my idol. So looking up to him too, man, it's like he was misunderstood as a kid. Deuce and them laid the foundation. Everybody always told me I wouldn't be like Deuce, so I was always shooting for the stars to try to be more like
try
him.
Try to show them, prove them wrong.
I'm a prove it wrong guy. So yeah, ultimately, those were the people that I looked up to.
Okay. Question number 4. How did you meet Mike Isman?
Man, we always knew each other. You know, he would come back to games when I played. I watched him play, and he was one of the dudes, like, I love swaggy dudes smooth dudes.
Smooth.
I feel like I'm smooth, and I go towards the guy that's more smooth. So watching him play, man, he had the dark visor on. That was one of the biggest things when he was young.
Everybody loved the visor, man.
So when I seen him play at Ole Miss, I like, man. So I watched him, and I followed him. So then when I got to playing, he would always come back, but we really never connected. But at one point, around about 2016, 2017, Ben Craddock, one of my best friends, love that guy to death. Ben, make sure you watch this, right?
Yeah.
So he told me, I was looking for a job at that time when I came back from Canada.
Right.
And he said, man, you need to go with your passion, man. Go ask Mike. You know, go talk to Mike about a job instead of trying to work at one of my stores. I was like, okay, Ben, make sure you give me the recommendation. Go talk to him for me. So he talked to him, and then, man, me and Mike hit it off. We just like brothers, man.
Oh,
like,
man.
When I say
nothing like it, man. Nothing like that brotherhood is grown bun.
Like, we can argue, bump heads all day, but we going to come right back, man. He's just like my brother, man, and he's very talented. He's one of the guys that got me going with training.
Right.
And taught me how to make money and structure of training and stuff, man. So that's my guy, man. Love him to death, Mike. I'm going to make sure you see this too, man.
I need to learn from y'all too, man. I need to learn from y'all. Y'all got to teach me some things that I don't know. Also, I can enlighten y'all in places that y'all may not know. So
we
can get together on that, man. Question number 5. What do you see yourself in the next 5 years? I know you said you're not leaving this school for the next 5 years, but what do you see yourself?
I see it in one of three ways, I would say. I say one, I would see myself going off and being a head coach somewhere.
Okay.
And making a new program great.
Is that here in Mississippi?
I hope it's in Mississippi.
Right.
Who never knows?
I
actually got a call about one of the biggest schools in Texas trying to recruit me over there to coach for them. But I doubt I'll leave. But, you know, I always want to keep my options open.
Right.
My second thing would be running my organization full time. Stop coaching at a school and running my organization full time. Because there's a lot of things that can go on in that. So that could be a possibility that I do in the next 5 years. And the last thing would be, which used to be number one for me, is going to college and coach. Everybody always asks me, why you go to college and coach? Why you go to college?
So you want to go to the next level?
I don't anymore necessarily, but if the right situation comes up, I will.
You
will
take it.
This is the problem about it. Having all those 4 and 5 stars, there's a rule in place that wherever they go, for 2 years you can't go.
Oh,
so I've got
man.
Offered a job at Ole Miss.
I've got offered a job at JUCO
and these other schools, but I can't take them because I fall up under the rule.
Man.
But me having my own organization makes me realize, like, man, nah, maybe I like more getting them to college.
Right, right.
It's gonna come to a fork in the road where I gotta choose eventually, or maybe I just stay coaching. I may stay here.
Right. I don't know. I think that's gonna be a. I think that's a great feeling, man. Knowing that you got them to the next level.
Right.
And rather than teaching them at the next level, knowing that you help somebody follow their dream, pursue their dreams, help them get exposed, help them get to the next level, I think that's one of the best feelings that, you know, you're doing right now. Question number six, what legacy do you hope to leave behind?
When somebody thinks of Shay, I want them to look back at it like a guy that cared. He really cared about the youth. He really cared about making an impact, you know, making sure I lived, you know, that I lived. And I hear about, you know, when people die and they talk about this person and that person. I want them at my funeral or when I'm done with everything, them to say, man, that dude cared. He cared about people. He cared about making people better, whether it was football, whether it was in real life, you know, because, like, I help a lot of people get job recommendations, getting them to college and stuff. So when they have my funeral, I want them to say, man, I want them to say he was a great guy.
Right.
He was a great guy. He did things for people and that He stood for what he stood for, you know, like that respect factor I talk about. I want that to be said, like, if he didn't agree with you on something, not that he would, like, go against you necessarily, but he stood on his morals and values.
Yeah, right.
Of what he believed.
We need more people to actually do that rather than, you know, branch out to the side and let people disrespect you, man. You got to always, you know, stand on your respect, man, because if you don't, others will step over you. You don't want that, man. As anybody as a human, do not want nobody to step over them. So, like, it's a mutual feel. I feel the same way, man. Question number seven, are you satisfied with where you are in life?
I'm satisfied to a certain extent, but I'm always that guy that reaches for more.
Right.
I'm always going to grow and get better and do more things. So I'm just looking at life as, like, I'm not content necessarily because you always got to grow.
Right.
But I'm just ready for the next challenge, man. I'm good at this level I'm at now, but there's still always another level to
it's
get.
It's always
always another level to get. So I would say I'm not happy where I'm at in life because I know it's a level I gotta get to.
Right.
To keep on growing.
Right. Like I said, once you get to high school, you wanna go to college. You go to college, you wanna go to NFL. You go to NFL, you think you're at the highest level. You never at the highest level. You always get better once you hit the NFL level. So that's like, you know, you always get better in every aspect. Even at the NBA, you know, same thing with basketball or whatever, you know. Oh, let me see this question. Got question number nine. What are your hopes and fears for the future?
My hopes for the future is, honestly, I want to put this on Mississippi. I want us to become more united.
Yeah, I agree with you.
That 7-on-7 realm and the football realm of everybody's trying to, you know, be the guy that's helping the kids. And most people care about the credit too much. Like, if I wasn't in the position that I'm in, I wasn't in the position I'm in. But I didn't realize who I was in the realm of football.
Right.
So I came under Demetri Moore.
Right.
He helped me get D.D. Boyd recruited. He helped me get Dawan Black recruited. Then we parted ways, you know. I figured out that I can do it myself. So my hopes is that Mississippi becomes more united and create tiers of where we can really help all these kids
out here.
Man. Because even if they're not a Power 5 kid or even a D1 kid, having people in place to get them to D2s and D3s JUCOs, being able to help everybody. And the only way it's going to happen is the adults get more unified and stop worrying about who gets the credit, because who's at the top is who's at the top. It's just like a team. Whoever becomes a star player becomes a star player. Now the other players have to become role players. So I guess the best way to say that, cuz, is to say, I wish everybody let the person, whoever Michael Jordan is, and let them be that, and then the other ones got to be my BJ Armstrong, Luke Longley, Tony Kukoc. They got to be the Bulls.
Right.
You got to have the pieces, because it never works unless you got all the pieces.
Right.
My fears is, I would put it in Jackson, man. I would say my fears is the kids keep going to the streets, you know, keep dying in these streets and keep thinking gang banging is the way of life.
It's not, man. It's not. It's only gonna lead you two places: jail or
dead.
Or dead. That's it, man.
And so that's my fear for everything and for everybody, and you know, like, school shootings and things.
Right. Oh, man.
Because our next generation is what's gonna propel us going forward. And if they're dying off and getting killed in crazy situations that shouldn't even happen, man, that's one of my biggest fears. Like, I got children, if they have another child. And I can only imagine somebody coming into school and shooting.
You said you having a what?
I'm going to have a little boy.
Oh, man. I'm getting all the exclusives right here, man. Congratulations to you, first of all.
Appreciate it,
man.
So, yeah, that's my fears. Now, I got a child coming, you know, another child coming into this world. And I can imagine somebody walking to the school and shooting my child and, like, how I would feel, man. So, that's one of my biggest fears about the youth and dying, man. Like, let those babies grow.
Right. They don't even get to live their life, man. It's a very sad situation, man. Question number 10. This is going to be last. What advice would you give to someone right now with your experience in life? It can be personal information, personal advice. It can be people want to go coach. Like, what advice do you have for anybody? Anybody with the experience you know? What did you know
with
now?
The experience I know and the people that I've been associated with, man, I'll tell you the first thing, one of the biggest things you need to find out, what are your values in life? Like, what do you value? That's like your handbook of who you are. Mine is, you know, I got five of them: faith, family, fun, finances, and I'm forgetting the last one. I think it's respect. I live by those, you know. When I get out of whack or anything, I go back to the boards that I got written in my room, and I calculate everything off of that. The second thing is, I would say, figure out your triggers, because everybody get mad at somebody.
Yeah, most definitely.
Somebody's going to make you mad. Figure out your triggers, man, and what is your game plan of how to get around that, or how to deal with it, right?
How
to deal with it. And the last thing I would say, I'm kind of being broad here with this, I'm not getting straight specifics, but growth. Always look for growth in everything you do. Like, and maybe handle this situation wrong. The next time, when it comes about, God's gonna keep giving you those same battles until you learn how to figure out how to navigate them, how to do it the right way. Then it will subside. I've had so many of those times in my life where it happened, and a lot of time I fail, man. But I just keep seeing myself grow, because when I do finally pass that I call it a level, I'd be like, man, I remember when I would react like this to that, but now I reacted like this to this, man. It's a great feeling. It's a win for me, you know. I'm always wanting to win. I'm a competitive guy. So that's one of the things I would say I would try to tell people from my experiences in life, is always try to grow, man. Figure out your values. Figure out what triggers you, and keep growing. No matter what, always keep growing. You can always get better.
Y'all hear the advice, man. Please take the advice. Listen to everything he just said. You know, he's been through it. He know what he's talking about, man. Just, you know. Great advice to anybody who's listening, man. I really want to thank you. That was my last and final question, man. I really want to thank you for allowing me to have you right here. You know, hopefully, you know, we can get around to more people that maybe that you have, that you want to, you know, get on here that may have, you know, that can inspire other people, which I don't know too many people. Well, I do know people, but I don't really know too many people who's not camera shy. Everybody I know is camera shy.
So right.
You may know people that's more influenced in the media and everything. So, you know.
You know, I definitely got you.
Some more. Hit that fast thing, speeding through the city. Panoramic brain in my dad's Gigi. Motherfucker fame on my nitty. Never to the face, I don't smoke no Philly. Dripping sauce like I'm chili. Set that flick came to the floor when it's chilly. I got three big booty bras at the telly. And then up from the store, who was ready? I can't with none of y'all. Y'all discuss me. When you with your maggot friends, don't discuss me. If I'm with a standing clip, I hope don't try to rush me. I am saying such and such, and I ain't gonna touch me.